The Proto-scene is the first era of Reccembra. Its beginning is marked by the evolution of simple cellular life, and its end is marked by the evolution of mobile multicellular organisms. In this time period, Reccembra's atmosphere was composed of 77% nitrogen, 19% oxygen, 2% methane, 1% argon, and 1% other gases. And the whole planet was a warm and humid place overall, with temperatures at the pole being over 20 degrees Celsius, and temperatures at the equator reaching 40 degrees. The evolution of cells. The first cellular organisms on Reccembra were quite simple, just the main RNA strand, now called the cell stem, and its molecular machines, encased inside a protein membrane. But it didn't take long for some new adaptations to arise. The first of these adaptations was the evolution of an efficient energy-making cellular machine, analogous to Earth's mitochondria. Just like the mitochondria, these machines, who were located at both ends of the cell stem, would take acetyl COA and convert it into ADP, which was used as an energy currency by the cells, using carbon dioxide and an electron chain. The acetyl COA needed for this process was made from glucose by molecular machines attached to the cell membrane. But this process was inefficient and severely restricted the amount of glucose which could be processed at a time. So once an adaptation arose which should bypass this, all cells with it thrived. This adaptation came in the shape of a ring of molecular machines surrounding the cell stem. Once separated from the cell membrane, the structure could grow far bigger and transform far larger quantities of glucose, which were transported from the cell membrane while special carrier machines walking on filaments inside the cell. It was at this point in the evolutionary timeline when two major lineages split, the annuli cells and the duacutians. The annuli cells were the cells which developed the ring to provide more energy, and the duacutians were cells which took advantage of the annuli cells and turned them into an organelle by a process of endosymbiosis, ensuring they had access to a far bigger amount of energy and thus could grow larger. Early duacutians had a difficult time reproducing, as, unlike annuli cells, which could simply duplicate their main structure and then divide, duacutians had to also make their organelles divide, where each of the offspring would only have half of them. So they evolved a way to signal them. Instead of simply waiting until enough materials had been gathered to divide, as their ancestors did, duacutians evolved specialized signaling molecules, which would be created by the cell stem when it was ready. These molecules would then tell the organelles to also start dividing, using the materials brought to them by carrier machines. And so, each offspring would contain the same amount of these organelles as the parent. Speaking of duacutians, while the first members of their lineage didn't have the adaptation they were named after, it was quick to evolve, and so all duacutians eventually had a second cell membrane protecting their cell stem, making it somewhat similar to the eukaryote cell's nucleus, although it had a completely different function. So, where is the genetic code in all of this? Well, the cell itself is its own genetic code, in a way. Instead of having a specialized place where the entire genetic code is stored, the instructions on how to run a cell are distributed across the thousands of different molecular machines operating inside the cell. There are machines which only know how to maintain the ring, then there are other machines which only know how to make those first machines, so on and so forth. This system is not nearly as efficient as the genetic code of Earth's life, but it's enough to get cells to replicate, and life would proliferate as long as something is just good enough.